God is good all the time. Yes. 2 Timothy chapter 2. We had a powerful revelation that was released to us Sunday. It was called the War of Wills. The war over your will. The Holy Spirit was expressing things about the war over our will, and our will is associated with your choice. So we know that there's influence for you that comes against me and you. It's a war over the wills. It's the will of man, which is the will of the devil, and the powers of darkness, or the will of God, one or the other. And in that influence that you and I are battling with all the time, it's trying to cause us to make a decision according to the worldly decisions, the emotion, or the flesh, and not according to truth. The more decisions you make according to the truth, you have more victory. And the more you change. Because what you sow is what you reap. So the more decisions you make that are not according to truth stalls you. It inhibits you. It prevents you from maturing and growing. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 11. Everybody there? Nice. Let's speak it together. This is a faithful saying. If we died with him. Now, wait a minute. That means if you denied yourself. Is everybody with me? If you died with him, you accepted his death, you died with him, you're rising. You're arising with him as a new creation. Amen? If we died with him, we shall also what? Live with him. If we endure temptations, hello, and attacks of the enemy, we shall also reign with him. Does everybody get it? If we deny him, in other words, we reject him, he also will deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful. In other words, he doesn't let go, we do. He cannot deny himself. He said, remind them of these things, charging them before the Lord not to strive about words to no profit, to the ruin of the hearers. Be diligent, which means consistent, to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. But it's important, he says, you need to shun something, profane and idle babbling. That is our voices, for they will increase to more ungodliness. And their message was spread like cancer. Hymenaeus and Philetus are of this sort, who have strayed concerning the what? Truth. In other words, they've fallen into compromise, complacency, and laziness. They fell from being hot to lukewarm, saying that the resurrection is already past, and they overthrow the faith of some. Nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands having this seal. The Lord knows those who are his, and let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity or sin or evil. But in the great house there are what? Not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter life, B.C., amen, he will be a vessel of honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. He gives us understanding. He says, look it, man, you need to maintain a pure heart and clean hands. So you need to flee also youthful lust, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call out on the Lord with a what? A pure heart. Everyone say pure heart. So in other words, associations bring impartations. Amen? You're hanging around with people that don't have a pure heart. You better be careful. But avoid foolish and ignorant disputes, knowing that they generate strife. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach. I wouldn't say able to teach. Patient, which means endurance. In humility, correcting those who are in opposition. If God perhaps will grant them repentance. So God's got to grant you repentance. See, there's times he allows you to continue to go. You may be crying out to God, Lord, forgive me, but your heart isn't right in true forgiveness. You repent because you got caught. See, that's sorrow of being caught. But true repentance means you actually turn. In other words, you're putting kingdom first, not yourself. True repentance, turning. Correcting those who are in opposition of God perhaps will grant them repentance so that they may know the what? The truth, the real truth. So they may come to true reality. And that they may come to their what? Senses. And escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive by him to what? To do his will. Wow. These senses are the snare of the enemy. In this, in other words, people are rejecting the voice. The voice, the influence of God. What's happening, there's a disconnect of reality. True reality. See, people living in the world are not walking in reality. They're walking in a false reality. They rely on everything they see, what they feel, and what they think. But there's another realm beyond that, which is the true reality. This is a temporary reality. They reject the voice of conviction, disconnecting them from the reality. And their will gets taken captive, so they make choices according to the influence of wickedness and evil instead of the influence of God. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, in verse 1, would you read it with me? But know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come. Are we in the last days? Amen. Is there perilous times?
Yes.
You betcha, man. There's a lot of influence. There's a lot of pressure. There's a lot of demonic. There's a lot of hatred in the air.
Amen.
A lot of bitterness. And a lot of lust and perversion in the air. It says, for men will be what? Lovers of what? Themselves. In other words, they'll put themselves first before kingdom or others. Lovers of what?
Money.
Boasters. What else? Proud. Blasphemers. Disobedient to parents. Unthankful. Unholy. Unloving. Unforgiving. Slanders without self-control. Brutal despisers of good. Traitors. Headstrong. Haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness or religiousness, but denying its power or trust. And from such people do what?
Turn away.
For these are the sort who creep into households and ministries and make captives of gullible men and women, loaded them down with sins, led away with various what?
Lust.
They're always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. They have a form of religious acts and good deeds, but not allow truth to dictate their will or their choice or decisions. Does everybody understand this? Verse 8. Now as Jannes and Jabez resisted Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, disapproved concerning the faith. But they will progress no further, for their folly will be made manifest to all, as theirs also was. But you have carefully followed my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, perseverance, persecutions, afflictions, which happened to me at Antioch and Iconium and at Lystra. What persecutions I endured, and out of them all the Lord did what? Delivered me. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. So don't think it's strange. But evil men and imposters will grow what?
Worse
and worse, deceiving and being deceived. In other words, they will be getting deceived and they will deceive others. But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them. And that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. He talks about evil men and imposters. They are rejecting the true interpretation of the Word of God. Neither able to rightly divide it. Some of them don't even read it, call themselves Christians. Amen? They don't believe the Word. These are all results. I'm going to explain to you something important. These are all results of what we call of a seared conscience. The enemy loves to come and sear your conscience. And I'm going to explain a little bit what's up. 1 Timothy chapter 4. A seared conscience. In verse 1, would you read it with me? We'll read the first four verses. Now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times, are we in the latter times? Amen? Amen. Some will what? Depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. A seared conscience, in other words, fried, cooked, severed. This conscience is an inner voice of creation, acting as a guide to righteousness and wrongness of one's behavior and decisions. You were born with this voice. It is called the voice of creation. See, you and I came from God. He did not send you without a voice. That voice that you have in you, what we call our conscience. Amen? It is a self-examining voice. It's a what? Self-examining voice of conviction. It's embedded in our human makeup of our soul. It's called your conscience. It is a voice. It was created with me. When God created you, He put a voice in us called a conscience. It guides you. So when that conscience is seared or severed, it means that the voice has been silenced, stopped. This was for intent of our creation. This was the intent of our Creator, who created us in love so we could be drawn into a relationship with Him, so as a pure conscience can replace any evil. Oh, hallelujah. In other words, when people use drugs, alcohol, satanic influence, satanic rituals, abuse, rituals, demonic, even music can sear your conscience. These things will sear your conscience so that the voice of creation, which is the voice of conviction, is no longer heard. It's seared, severed. And that's what the enemy wants to do. If he can get us in a place of this, we get disconnected. And it happens quickly. It only takes one decision to begin the searing of your conscience. In John chapter 8. Some people are trying to hear the voice of God when they can't even hear the voice of their own conviction, their conscience. And God will speak through that voice to you. Amen. He created you with that voice to guide us. So he wouldn't, in other words, he said, I'll never leave you. Well, he never left us. He gave us a voice. It's called the voice of the conscience, voice of creation. It's a voice of conviction. It guides you. When we were young, and everything you do, every one of us in this room knew that we were doing something wrong when we were doing it. Amen? And we were doing something right when we were doing it. In fact, it gave us a good feeling. Whoa, I did something right finally. And when you make a decision, you know whether that's the wrong one or the right one. Amen? In John chapter 8, we'll start at verse 1. Hallelujah. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Now early in the morning he came again into the temple. And all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. Then the scribes and Pharisees brought to him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such be stoned. But what do you say?" This they said, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. Now, remember, these were demonic forces that were using these Pharisees and Sadducees to try and entangle Jesus. But he knew it. And we should know it. Because you have the anointing of the Holy Spirit. You should be able to see through people. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with his finger as though he did not hear. I think he said, "Come out," I don't know. Or "Get behind me." So when they continued asking him, he raised himself and said to them, "He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first." And again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. Then those who heard it, being convicted by their what? Conscience, a voice of conviction kicked in. Now, I want you to know, before they got near Jesus, their conscience was seared. But when you get near Jesus, you can't help it. And they went out one by one, beginning with the oldest, even to the last, and Jesus was left alone with the woman standing in the midst. And when Jesus raised himself up and saw no one, but the woman, he said to her, "Woman, where are those accusers of you? Has no one condemned you?" And she said, "No one, Lord." I want you to grab hold of something. She said, "Lord." In other words, in this, there was a repentant heart. She bowed before him, kneeled before him. She was repentant, and she acknowledged him as Lord. Oh, man, when you get humble and you get before him, and you humble yourself, and you repent for those things, and you acknowledge him as Lord, he begins to restore. Woo. And she said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said to her, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Why? Because her conscience that was seared was restored also. So now she was restored to the voice of creation that was imparted in us, known as the voice of conviction that will guide us to what is righteous and what is wrong. Amen? And Jesus spoke to them again, saying, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life." Powerful. See, there's so much false religion. Religion sears your conscience because you rely on your intellect instead of relationship. Sears the conscience until we get around Jesus. And then that self-examining voice of creation is able to convict and turn the heart. Amen? In Matthew 25. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Matthew 25, verse 31. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the what? Goats. Sheep are obedient, submissive, and followers. Goats are rebellious. In other words, he's showing ones that have a conscience and those that are seared and those that are not. Goats are seared. And he will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goat's on the left. Now, there's no coincidence that we have a government that's right and left. I'm telling you right now, you can look at it. You see the fruit. The left, and it's amazing how many people are voting for people that approve abortion, same-sex marriage. Their conscience is seared. And the devil has succeeded in doing that. And this is not about a political thing. This is about reality of what is righteous and what is wicked. Lie, cheat, just like their father, the devil. Is everybody okay? Woo-hoo. Verse 34. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, come you, blessed of my father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when do we see you sick and in prison and come to you? And the king will answer and say to them, as surely as I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. Then he will also say to those on the left, boy, are they expect, I don't know what that, man, they don't get it. Then they will say to the ones on the left, depart from me, you what? Cursed. Again, it's baffling to me where people call themselves believers and voted for Obama. And everyone associated with it because they are of wickedness. I'm telling you that the Democratic Party is one of the most wicked organizations in the world, and they are associated with all other wicked organizations. And their purpose is to bring down the kingdom of God. But their conscience is seared where there is no conviction. None. There's no conviction. The voice of creation that was given to them has been shut up, seared. Or they'd be repenting for everything they approved of. And then he will say to those on the left, depart from me, you curse, into the everlasting fire. Prepare for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not take me in. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they will also answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger and naked and sick or in prison and did not minister to you? Then he will answer them, and saying, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. In other words, when they were doing anything, they were promoting themselves. They were never giving God the glory. And these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into everlasting life. Does everybody see that? Oh, hallelujah. In Romans chapter 1, we are seeing this battle. Tremendous battle right now. And it's those who have a seared conscience and those that don't. Oh, they may be churchgoers, but they have no understanding to divide the word correctly. No interpretation by the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Romans chapter 1 and verse 18. Let's speak it, please. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. Well, yeah, why? Because every one of us has a voice of creation. It is the voice of conviction. But when it gets seared, that voice is rejected. For since the creation of the world. His invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, and even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they were without what? Excuse. No one has an excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile. Futile. In other words, that word futile means useless. Useless. Became futile in their thoughts. There was no righteous purpose. Why? Because their conscience was seared. And their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lust of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use of what is against nature. Likewise, also men, leaving the natural use of a woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men, committing what is shameful and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error, which is due. I want you to grab hold of something. Homosexuals, lesbians, and transgenders have a seared conscience. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God they gave them over to a base mind to do those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, knowing that the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but also approve of those who practice them. That's pretty wild, isn't it? So those who approve of those wicked things are going to be judged the same way. Why? Because their conscience is seared too. Wow. Result is the wrath of God, futile in their thoughts because of the seared conscience. They're incapable of producing anything useful. The result, any useful result, in other words, it becomes to an area that's pointless, vain, or ineffective in their thoughts. This is where we are right now today. This is what's going on all over the world. People's conscience is becoming seared. In Romans chapter 9. Romans 2, while we're there first. Verse 12. Let's speak it. For as many as have sinned without law will also perish without law, and as many as have sinned in the law will be judged by the law. For not the hearers of the law are just in the sight of God, but the doers of the law will be justified. For when Gentiles who do not have the law by nature do the things in the law. By nature do the things in the law. Why? Because of a conscience, the voice of conviction, which guides you and I to righteousness and guides us in the area where we know we're going to commit something wrong. He says no. These, although having the law, are a law to themselves. Verse 15, who show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, and between themselves, their thoughts accusing or else excusing them. In the day when God will judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel. That's powerful. Why? Because this conscience of ours is a self-examining voice. It's a what? Self-examining voice. It is the voice that God has placed as a part of your human nature, soul makeup that God has given me and you. It is the voice that is within you. It's called your conscience. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's go to Romans 9. In verse 1, please. Is everybody there? Is everybody okay? Let's speak it. I tell the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience also bearing me witness in what? The Holy Spirit. I love this. Why? Because there's a union between your conscience voice and the voice of the Holy Spirit. That I have great sorrow and continue to grieve in my heart, for I could wish that I myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my countrymen, according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertain the adoption and the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, and the service of God, and the promises, of whom are the fathers, and from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came, who is over all the eternal blessed God. Amen. But it is not that the word of God has taken no effect, for they are all Israel who are Israel, nor are they all children, because they are the seed of Abraham. And Isaac, your seed, shall be called. That is, those who are children of the flesh, these are not children of God. And I want you to grab hold that children of the flesh have a seared conscience. But the children of the promise are counted as the seed. For this is the word of promise. At this time I will come, and Sarah shall have a son. Hebrews chapter 3. So that's why the word says something very important. He says, make no place for the devil. Why? Because he knows that when he accesses you, his purpose is trying to sear your conscience. He's trying to stop that voice of self-examination, that voice of conviction. He's trying to separate the union between the voice of creation and me and you and the voice of the Holy Spirit. Hebrews 3 and verse 7. Is everybody there?
Amen.
Let's speak it together. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion, and the day of trial in the wilderness, where your fathers tested me, tried me, and saw my works 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation. I said, they always go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swore my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief and departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ if we do what? Hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. While it is said, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in rebellion. A hardened heart is a seared conscience. You may remember when we started to do certain things. In other words, maybe the first time you picked up a cigarette and there was a conviction. Or the first time you picked up a drink. Or the first time whatever. There was a conviction. The first time you stole something. Then as you continued to do it, your conscience got seared. And then there was a justification now. The conviction was replaced by reasoning. Has everybody got it? And there was, or what we call excuses. And we just kept doing it and doing it and doing it and doing it until finally we hit wall of reality. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. In 2 Timothy 4. In 2 Timothy 4 and verse 1, he You know, as you begin really to look around the world and see what's going on, you can see how many individuals' conscience is seared. It's terrible. It's terrible. Again, think about it. I'm not against an individual. I'm not against political or anything. I'm against evil. And it's our job as children of the Most High God, as light carriers of the Most High God, to expose darkness. That's our responsibility. It's our responsibility also to drive it out. In verse 1, I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who would judge the living and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort, with all what? Long suffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Why? Seared conscience. But according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers that also have a seared conscience. And they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. But you be watchful in all things, endure afflictions, do the work as an evangelist or as a witness, fulfill your ministry or your calling. Does everybody get this? Itching ears. Why? Because of a what? Seared conscience. In James 4. James 4 and verse 7. You know, one of the things the enemy likes to do is in the area of abusing children. He knows that if he can get to the children, he can sear their conscience. That's where you have dual personalities, double-mindedness, instabilities, all kinds of things. He's wicked. Very wicked. And people don't take it serious. In James 4 and verse 7, therefore do what? Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you what? Double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will what? He will lift you up. In other words, there's a double-mindedness. One of the things God's trying to do is get us like-minded. Amen? Like-minded. Result is double-mindedness. Why? Well, seared conscience. Instability. In Titus chapter 1. Titus chapter 1. Man, everywhere Jesus went, man, there was conviction, you know? I love it. Even when he was, what, 11 or 12, what he booked. He didn't go home with the rest of the family. They were looking for him. Where'd they find him? He was in the temple teaching those who were supposedly taught. Pharisees and Sadducees. And the things that he was sharing with them because of his presence, here he was teaching them the things of the Word of God. And they're like, man, where'd you come from? And of course, mom and dad came, showed up, grabbed him by the ear and said, come on, boy. He said, man, where you been? He said, don't you know I'm about my Father's business? But mom was instructed already what to do. I said, come on. We don't want everyone to know who you are yet. Oh, hallelujah. In Titus chapter 1, is everybody there? In verse 10, I think. Yeah, 10. For there are many, what? Insubordinate, both idle talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole households, teaching things which they ought not, for the sake of dishonest gain. One of them, a prophet of their own, said, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. This testimony is true. Therefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in faith, not giving heed to Jewish fables and commandments of men who turn from the truth. To the pure, all things are pure. But to those who are defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. But even their mind and their conscience are what? Defiled, in other words, seared. They profess to know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable, disobedient, and disqualified for every good work. Wow. In other words, there be also, look at, when there is a seared conscience, there is a disqualification to partake of the divine nature. 2 Timothy chapter 1. In verse 3. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 3. Let's speak it. I thank God whom I serve with a pure conscience. Everyone say pure conscience. So can you serve God without a pure conscience? No. No, you can't. As my forefathers did, as without ceasing I remember you in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded is in you also. Therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. So will fear sear your conscience? Oh, you know it. You allow fear in. That's where people become, it says, the word says, be anxious for nothing. See, if you don't overcome that and you continue to allow that to happen to you, your conscience will become seared and you will no longer hear that voice of conviction. Does everybody get this? Amen. See, so many people want things done right now, right away, and won't wait on God. You allow, there's so many steps that you do that, next thing you know, your conscience is seared and you're stuck in that place. Now you're in the flesh and you're not partaking in the divine nature. You're actually on your own. Amen? I want to close at 2 Peter chapter 1. So you can go home and eat popcorn.
2 Woohoo!
1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 2. Second Peter chapter 1 verse 2. Are we there? Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. As his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly and great precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. So, will fornication sear your conscience? Oh, yeah. Like I said, sometimes you may remember the first time, but then after that, it was like, ah. You can only enjoy sin so long. Verse 5. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to what? Blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Why? Because his conscience has been seared. Now, can a person that has a seared conscience get restored? Yes. Yes. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election. For if you do these things, you shall what? Never what? Stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly in the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For this, I will not be negligent to remind you always of these things, though you know and are established in the present truth. So we need to be reminded. That's what we call being refreshed. That's why we gather together. That's why we read the word. That's why we praise and worship. But you don't want to leave here without taking this word, mixing it with faith, and get it in you and practice it. Put it to practice. Bring it to remembrance. Let the voice of creation, that self-examining voice, convict. We should look for conviction, not wait for it. Does everybody get that? If you're waiting for conviction, you're already out of order. If you're looking for conviction, you're going to get in order. Amen? Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We're honored and blessed of revelation and impartation. Let your word, your seed that's been imparted in us, not only bring revelation and illumination, but protect it by the blood of Jesus so the enemy does not steal it. And we repent for any areas where we've allowed the enemy to sear our conscience. And we ask, Lord, a restoring of our conscience so that it may be pure, so that we may be partakers of the divine nature and express your will, your love, your kingdom, and your power in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.
Amen.
Be blessed and stay dressed.